not what you think. You know, once again, I want to let you know how much I truly appreciate that you joined us this morning. And, you know, I'm really, this sort of sounds weird, but I want to give a great big shout out to those the people that watch us online, the ones that watch us on our YouTube channel. We've actually increased ever since our app has been introduced. The number of people watching on YouTube and other places are starting to really grow. So one of the reasons we do that is if you can't come to church, we want to take the church to you. We believe that that by teaching more, that we're going to reach more, and we're fulfilling the gospel, the great commission of Jesus Christ, who says take the gospel around the world. But for those of you who get up and get dressed and come here, we certainly appreciate you, because this is summertime. There's a lot of places that are telling you, a lot of places you could be. So the fact that you choose to be here is just so important, and we thank you so much. We really love it when you decide to be here. And today is a great day to be at the Odyssey Church, because we're going to be talking about what Jesus says. Now, this is not what I say, but Jesus says is the evidence that he's going to let us into his heaven on Judgment Day. On that day when we stand before him, how do we know that we're going to get into heaven? I think that's an important question. Now, if you're here today and you're not a Christian, and you haven't decided Jesus is your Lord and Savior, just listen along, because the things that we talk about, whether you believe in Jesus, will still work and applicable for your life. And if you are a Christian, I'm warning you to listen to this and look at your own heart. Don't start pointing fingers. Don't say, well, I really wish my husband was here, because he really needs to hear this message. And that's how legalism starts in the church, isn't it? You know, we start hearing these messages, and then instead of judging our own heart, we start judging those around us. Are they really a Christian? Are they really that? And that's not how we should look at God's Word. We should look at God's Word through the filter of our own heart and worry about ourselves and not worry about our neighbor. Let our neighbor take care of themselves when it comes to their salvation. And that's why so many people have been hurt in churches. That's why so many Christians have hurt other people. And their intentions aren't bad. I don't think they purposely do it. They just do it because instead of looking at their own heart, instead of looking at God's Word as an application for their life, they're trying to apply it for everybody else. And I think this is an important message. If you call yourself a Christian, I think it's an important message, and I think Jesus confirms this, because I believe, and Jesus again confirms it, that it takes a whole lot more to get into heaven than what we think it does. Okay? It takes a whole lot more for us to stand before God and him ask, why should I let you into my kingdom? And here's why. If you were to look and ask, and you were like a roving reporter, and you went down the street, and you were to ask 100 people what it means to be a Christian, you would probably get 100 different answers. You know, they might say, well, Christian is like that person over there, but not like that person over there who says they're a Christian. You know, there's all kinds of different things that people say when you ask them what it means to be a Christian, or what is a Christian. And if you ask 100 people, you would be lucky if you got the same answer twice. Now, if you would take the same 100 random people and just ask them if they were a Christian, according to the statistics, 72 of them would say, yes, I'm a Christian. Now, to me, that is a little discerning. And the reason it's discerning is because just 8 years ago, 82 of them would say they were a Christian. And just 25 years ago, in 1995, 90 of those same 100 people would have said they were a Christian. So we're looking at, percentage-wise, a very huge, considerable drop in the number of people in this nation who say they were a Christian. But if you were to ask 100 people if they were Christian, statistically, you would get between 70 and 72 people that said they were Christians. But if you were to ask it a different way and say, what does it mean to be a Christian, you'd get as many answers probably as the people you ask. And here's why. The Bible never defines what it means to be a Christian.
Amen.
And And here's something you might know, or if you've been coming here for a while, you may already know, because I've mentioned it before. The Greek word that we translate Christian, the Greek word, it's Christianos, only appears three times in our Bible. It's only there three times. So our Bible doesn't define what it means to be a Christian. In fact, if you would take the three places that the word Christian is used and put it under a microscope, what you would find out is not only the word Christian not defined, as it's used in Scripture, at the time it was used in history, when it was first awarded, originated, or first coined, it is a derogatory word. It is not a good word. It was the word that the people outside the Jesus community called the people who were inside the community. The people that were inside the community of Jesus did not call themselves Christians. Now, there's a lot of examples we could use, but I think the one that probably resonates with most of us is, you remember when you were in high school? Now, that for me, that was a long time ago. But you always had names for certain groups of people, don't you? I mean, you had names for the people around you who weren't the people that were in your group. They were in a different group. It happens everywhere, but really, I think school's the best example most of us can relate to. Now, the names that we chose usually weren't meant to be encouraging. They weren't meant to be a very nice word. I mean, some of the names that we used when I was in school, we probably couldn't even say in church. But some of the ones that I could say, and I'm sure these words have changed since the Stone Ages when I was in high school, but you know, we had the jocks, we had the preppies, we had the eggheads, we had the nerds, we had the stoners, you know, we had all of those and a few more. Certain groups of girls, you know, they had their own name, and certain groups of boys, they had their own name. You know, certain cliques got their own distinction, their own name. But the thing about it is, the groups that we called these names usually didn't call themselves by the same names, did they? It was sort of the derogatory term we would use. It was the names that people outside their group that would call them. So I think you probably get what I'm talking about now. And that's how the word Christian came about. You know, you'd be walking down the street and say, see those people over there? They're tax collectors. Ooh, you don't want nothing to do with tax collectors. I don't want to be part of that group. You see those people over there? They're lepers. They're outcasts. Ooh, stay away from them. You see that group over there? They're Christians. Get away from them altogether. And it was the people who outside the Jesus community who coined the word Christian, and it was first used in a town called Antioch. The first time the word Christian is used is in a letter written by a man named Luke. And this was Luke's second letter that he wrote. He wrote the history of Jesus' life based on the evidence of the witnesses he talked to, and he was very careful in defining it. We call it the Gospel of Luke today, but it was really just a letter that he wrote. And then we have the Acts of the Apostle, or the Book of Acts, as we call it today. And this was his second letter that he was writing. He wrote both letters to a man named called Theophilus. Now, some people believe that he wasn't writing it to a man, he was writing to a group of people, because the name Theophilus means lover of God. So whether he was writing it to a man named Theophilus, or he was writing to a group of people named Theophilus, if you love God, the letter is intended for you. So in Luke's second letter, beginning in chapter 11, verse 26, in the book of Acts, it says, so for a whole year, Barnabas and Saul later became known as Paul, met with the church and taught great numbers of people, the disciples, and we'll come back to that word. The disciples were called Christians first at Antioch. Now, if you're not familiar with Scripture, not familiar with how these people that they're now calling Christians ended up in the town called Antioch, I'm going to give you the short version. I don't have time to go into the whole thing, but Antioch was a town outside Jerusalem. After Jesus died and he rose again, Jerusalem became a dangerous place for Jesus' followers. Now, initially they were called the Way. And they were called the Way because Following Jesus was not something you did on church on Sunday morning. Following Jesus wasn't something you said you were. Following Jesus was your way of life. So they were known as the Way. But after this group of people in Jerusalem had seen Jesus, after they had saw him dead, and now they've seen him alive, and they knew he was dead, and they start to hear him speak to him after they saw he was buried in a grave, they had a renewed sense of purpose. They were excited. They were ecstatic. And they began to cause trouble in the town because they were getting other people excited. So now the Jewish leaders who didn't believe Jesus was the Messiah, they're getting upset with these new group of people, these Jesus followers who had their renewed energy and renewed purpose because they've seen Jesus rise from the grave, or they've seen Jesus after he was dead and is now alive. And the Roman leaders saw him as a threat. So they had begun, these followers of Jesus, to become very persecuted. They had begun getting arrested and tortured and even killed in some cases. And it was happening to both the Jews and the Romans. So due to this severe persecution, they began to run for their lives. They began to leave Jerusalem and go into other towns. And as they went into these other towns, they began to tell other people about this Jesus who they had witnessed alive. They had heard him speak after they knew he was dead. They began telling his teaching. And these other people, their stories were so convincing at the time that these other people began to put their faith and their trust into Jesus. And they began to follow Jesus. And one of the towns that they began to do this in was the town of Antioch. They had been persecuted. The Bible says they were dispersed. Now, you're being persecuted, you don't think of being dispersed. When the Bible says they were being dispersed, that meant somebody was doing the dispersing. God was dispersing them to spread the gospel, to spread the news of Jesus Christ around the world. And the way he dispersed them wasn't the most pleasant way. I would like God to show up in an air-conditioned airplane and take me to Antioch. But he didn't do that. He's in there and he's persecuting the people. They're running for their life. And the disciples were first called Christians at Antioch. It was a label that was put on them, not a label that put on themselves. These Jesus followers didn't call themselves Christians. The outsiders, the non-Christians, called the Jesus followers Christians. Now, the second time we see this word Christian used is again in the book of Acts written by Luke. And we move to chapter 26, verse 28. And this is pretty interesting because Saul, who became Paul, Paul has been arrested for preaching and teaching the word of Jesus. Now, he's in prison for preaching the word of Jesus. And what does he do? He goes to the king, a man by the name of King Agrippa, the man who holds the power to release him, to keep him in jail, or even execute him. And he doesn't go to beg to be out of jail. He doesn't go to ask to be out of jail. He doesn't say, I won't do it any again. He begins to preach Jesus to King Agrippa. Now, how crazy is that? I mean, some people might say, how brave is that? I'm thinking in my mind, wait a minute. This is the guy who put you in jail, and now you're trying to tell him the very same thing that got you in jail. Agrippa interrupted him. Do you think you can persuade me to be a Christian so quickly? And I think he's like, Paul, are you crazy? I locked you up for being one of those people, one of those peace-disturbing Christians. And now you want me to become one too? You want me to become one of those people? Paul, do you hear yourself? I don't think so. And finally, the last mention of the word Christian is in the Apostle Peter's first letter, first epistle, first letter, and we find it in chapter 4, chapter 16. And it says, however, if you suffer as a Christian, do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear his name. If someone calls you a Christian and they're persecuting you for it, and you have to suffer, don't take it as an insult like they intended. I want you to be glad. I want you to be happy because the root of the word comes from Christ himself. The root means that you now have the privilege to suffer because somebody is calling you by the same name as your Savior.
That's right. Amen.
So the word Christian is never defined in your Bible. So you can do anything, you can be anything, and you can still call yourself a Christian. But there is a word that the Scripture calls the followers of Jesus. There is a word that Jesus himself called his followers, a word that his followers called himself and called each other. And that word is very, very, very defined in Scripture. To quote Andy Stanley, they called them something much more terrifying, something much more defined, something far more disturbing, something far more convicting than Christian, unquote. One of the reasons you can't get even a few people to agree with what it means to be a Christian, one of the reasons there are so many different doctrines, one of the reasons there are so many different denominations, one of the reasons there are so many different non-denominations with different bylaws and different beliefs and different ways of doing things, the reason that Christians are divided on almost every single subject. You can be a Christian and say, I'm a Republican. You can be a Christian and say, I'm a Democrat. You can look at the other person and say, you're a Republican. You can't be a Christian. You can look at a person, and we like to fight over everything. You know? Should we have the death penalty? Should we not? Christians on both sides. You know? We're currently in a battle in the churches over the homosexual agenda, which is ridiculous because God says love everybody. But you can be a Christian, and Christians fight over every single thing. Do we have the gifts of the Spirit anymore? Do God still do miracles on that? You can do anything you want, say anything you want, and call yourself a Christian because nobody can go to Scripture, point at a verse, and say you're not a Christian because of this. You can't do it. Christian is not defined. But there is a word which is used over on the translation, 300 times in the New Testament alone, the word the Bible uses to describe the followers of Jesus, the word Jesus used to describe his followers, the words the followers of Jesus describe himself is clearly defined in the Bible, and the word is disciple. Disciple, not Christian. So you can hide behind being a Christian all day long and do anything you want, because Christian is not defined. Nobody can point at a verse and say that's not being a Christian. Being Christian is never defined in the Bible. But what you can't hide behind is the word disciple. Because disciple, the word disciple, isn't only defined in the Scriptures by the Scriptures themselves. Jesus himself defines what it means to be a Christian. So if you have been hurt by Christians before, if you have been wondering about this Christian thing altogether, don't let that stop you from seeking Jesus Christ. Because Christianity, and in the name of Christianity, has done much damage throughout the world throughout the years. But I want to challenge you this morning. Because Jesus said, if you want to be my disciple, and then he goes and tells us what it means to be his disciple. Morning, I want to dare you, I want to triple dare you, I want to challenge you, I want you to be dared to be a disciple. Now, in order to show you what it means to be a disciple, so that you can have the confidence, so that you will enter into heaven and hear the words, well done, good and faithful servant, enter into the joy of your master. And not here, take this wicked and slothful servant away from me to a place where there is weeping and gnashing of the teeth. I want to use the words that Jesus spoke himself. You know, sometimes here you get the fluff and sometimes you get the fire. And today's message may sort of be a convicting message. But it's only convicting if you look within your own heart. The problem with words like this is we look at this and we say, well, I wish that person over here had heard that, or I wish I'm taping this because I want my husband to hear. In fact, I think I'll underline some words for him. And we don't look at our own heart. So to do this, I want to turn to what most everyone would agree, even some of those people who may not even consider themselves to be Jesus followers or even believe in God, would agree that it's the greatest sermon that's ever been preached. Now, it's found in the Gospel of Matthew, or in the book of Matthew, or in the history of Jesus' life, written by one of Jesus' closest friends, one of the people who witnessed the very things that he wrote down when Jesus roamed the earth, and it's called the Sermon on the Mount. And the Sermon on the Mount is found in chapters 5 through 7 in the book of Matthew. Now, I'm gonna tell you, when I first started going to church when I was younger, I thought the Bible was simply a book of verses and short stories. Because when I went to church, the pastor would speak out, and he'd have one or two key verses, and he would speak on one of those key verses and keep pounding them in. Or they would tell a story like the prodigal son, which is a great story. But until I started reading the Bible for myself, I didn't realize that there was a continuous theme and that these weren't a book of short stories and a book of just verses. It was a collection. It was a collection of ancient, and this should be enough to get you to believe in God himself. It was a collection of ancient historical accounts. It was a collection of ancient letters. It was a collection of ancient manuscripts, which had been preserved for thousands of years and put together in the form of what we now call our Bibles. And over time, man has broken our Bible down into chapters, they've broken it down into verses, and then they went a little bit farther and even broke it down into sections. And some of your Bibles, like the NLT I normally speak from, has different subheadings. Now, I believe that the Bible truly is the inspired Word of God. I truly believe it. I believe it's inerrant, which means it's without error, it's infallible, it won't fail, that it is God breathed it, it was inspired by God himself in its original form. Man has translated it, and sometimes the translations don't come together perfectly, so there is one Bible who might claim this, and there's another Bible who might claim this, but we have to remember, 98 point something of everything in every translation is exactly the same and means exactly the same. So why are we arguing over 1%? You know, it doesn't make sense to me. But the fact of the matter is, the Bible is inspired. I even believe, and I'm not going to go into that today, that the actual way the books are lined up, the 66 books of the Bible, even that's inspired. There's a pattern to how the books are lined up. But what I don't believe is inspired is how it's broken down. Now it's broken down into chapters. Sometimes the chapter actually ends in a strange place and a new chapter starts. The verses, I don't think, are necessarily inspired, even though all translations now use the same, but sometimes they end in weird places and start. But if there's anything that I know for sure is not inspired, it's the subtitles, because every translation has different subtitles. But because of the way the word is spoken by pastor, because there's no way we can, unless you're long-winded like me, can go through some of the entire passages and everything they mean, sometimes we forget that these are one continuous long letter written at about the same time, that these are sometimes one long speech written at the same time. And the greatest example of that is the Sermon on the Mount, which is the longest recorded continuous sermon of Jesus, the longest continuous words of Jesus that are recorded in the New Testament. So, as we look at this, we have to remember that chapters 5 through 7, if you have a red letter Bible is a Bible that shows the words of Christ in red, all three chapters are continuously, and almost a little paragraph at the beginning of 5 and a paragraph at the end of 7, but other than that, everything's written in red. Now, the Sermon on the Mount is spans over these three chapters of the Gospel of Matthew. What Jesus does is he begins by leaning into the people there that day. He begins by leaning into the, or reading it. He begins by leaning into all of us. And he begins to tell us the blessings of following him. We call it the Beatitudes. The Beatitudes mean blessing. So he tells us the blessings of being his disciple. And then he goes into, okay, this is what a disciple should do, and this is what a disciple shouldn't do. This is how a disciple should act, and this is how a disciple shouldn't act. And then he gives us this very, very, very scary, worse than any kind of horror film you've ever seen, this terrifying warning about what happens to those who are not his disciples, the one who calls themselves Christians. And this is the interesting part, because he's talking to people who are calling themselves Christians and think they're okay, but they're not okay. But Jesus is a master teacher, so he wraps everything up with an application. This is how you will know that you are welcome into my kingdom, and this is how you do what is necessary to get there. Now, Jesus loves us so much, he wants us to know without question, without hesitation, that we can be assured of our salvation. And for some people, this may seem condemning, and I don't mean it to be at all, but you have to look at this through the lens of, this is Jesus' talk. This is Jesus' sermon, not Rob's sermon. And he starts this sermon out in the most magnificent way. He tells us of the blessings of being his disciples, but when we start reading them, they don't always look like a blessing. Jesus is the master teacher. He takes what doesn't look like a blessing and shows us why it is actually a blessing. He ends up this entire section of Scripture, this section we now call the Beatitude, which means blessings, in this very strange way. He ends it like this. He said, God blesses those who are persecuted for doing right. Don't seem like a blessing. Are you going to bless me by persecuting me? For the kingdom of heaven is there. All right, you're being persecuted, but you have a great reward for it. God blesses you when people mock you, when they persecute you, when they lie about you, when they say all sorts of evil things against you because you're one of my followers. Be happy about it. In fact, just don't be happy about it. Be very glad about it, for great rewards await you in heaven. And if you're like me, you're thinking, wait a minute, Jesus. Persecution for doing what's right? Well, that doesn't seem like a blessing. Being lied about? For having all sorts of evil things being done at just because I'm a Jesus follower? Well, that doesn't sound like a blessing. That don't sound like that's right. But I think if Jesus were here on earth in his human form again, I don't think he'd like the way a lot of churches are preaching.
Amen.
I don't think he'd like the way a lot of churches are saying how easy it is to be a Christian, how easy it is to get into the kingdom of God. I think what Jesus is telling us is that it takes a lot more to follow him than just saying you're a Christian. That you have to become a true, faithful disciple. And that's more than just saying you're a Christian. That's more than just going to the altar one time. That's more than signing a card at the end of a service or raising your hand at home. What he's saying is you're going to have to take some action. Words alone are not going to be your salvation. In fact, the scripture says we are to be sanctified. Sanctified is a word that means we're set apart. He says you need to set yourself apart from the rest of the world so much that the rest of the world notices. We are in the world, but we are not of the world. And when you do that, people will come against you. And people will lie about you. And people will persecute you for it. And I am here to tell you, this is true. I have firsthand experience in this. But he said, it is worth it. It is worth it. You should be happy about it. For great are the rewards for those who follow me, for those who are truly my disciples. I think Jesus could sort of sum all this up by saying, choosing to follow me is not the easiest life that you can choose. It's not the easiest life in this world, but it is absolutely the best life. It's not easy, but it's worth it. He says, dare to be a disciple, because the rewards that are waiting for you. Chapter 5, verse 12. Be happy about it. Be very glad. For great rewards await you in heaven. And remember, the ancient prophets were persecuted in the same way. He said, it's not going to be easy. But if it was easy, it probably wouldn't be worth it. It wasn't easy for the ones before you. It won't be easy for the ones after you. But those who dare to be a disciple, the rewards are better than you could ever even imagine. You may not get all your rewards in this world, but you can be sure of great rewards in the next world. And these rewards are greater than anything that this world has to offer. These rewards will not go away when you stand before me. These rewards will last for all of eternity. And then Jesus begins to go into the meat of his sermon. He starts to talk about how we're to be the salt. How we're to be the flavor. How we're supposed to be the light to the world by letting everybody else see our good deeds, our good works, our good actions. Not so that we can be glorified. So I'm quoting Jesus here. Let your good deeds shine out for all to see so that everyone will praise your heavenly Father. You know, we learned on Wednesday night, we're talking about the Holy Spirit. When Peter spoke that day, he spoke in language. And everybody understood the language at the same time. He preaches this sermon. 3,000 people got saved that day, but not one of them said, Peter, what a great sermon. They said, what a great God.
That's right.
And see, that's my prayer every time I speak, is at the end, it's not, Rob, you preached a good sermon. Rob, thank you for showing us this great God that we have. I want you to see Jesus. I don't want you to see Rob. It's never about our glory. It's never about the things we get. Because we're going to be lied about, we're going to be mocked, we're going to be persecuted. It's about God the Father, and our good works, our good deeds, our good actions should always bring glory to God the Father. Yeah. Not to ourselves. And then Jesus, these teachings sometimes, you know, and this is the disturbing part about what's being preached in some churches today. Jesus was this magnificent teacher, and his message was so different than what was being talked about. Because the Pharisees and the Sadducees, who were the religious leaders of the time, they had made this law so difficult, so burdensome, that nobody could follow. And Jesus comes with this message of love, and this message of grace, and this message of mercy. And it was something new, and the people were flocking to him. But he never compromised the Word of God to do that. So when Jesus starts teaching about the law, he doesn't water it down. He doesn't say, hey, you know, this is okay. You know, God will forgive you for this. He actually raises the bar. He actually takes the law and then raises the bar. The law is the Ten Commandments. He don't just say, follow the law. He begins to explain the law. He said, to enter into the kingdom of heaven, you've got to be more righteous than anybody else. In fact, you've got to be more righteous than the most righteous person preaching the Word of God today. You can't enter into the kingdom unless you're that way. Most of the people are going, well, I can't be like, those are the professional people. They know the ones that knew the Scripture and memorized the entire Torah, which is the first 5 books of the Bible, by the time we're 12. How am I supposed to live up to that? Scripture says, the law says, do not murder. I tell you, don't even be angry with your brother. Because if you're angry with your brother, you deserve the same punishment as the guy who murdered. Everybody in the crowd went, well, that's hard. I got mad this morning at my wife. If you lust in your heart, it's the same thing as committing adultery. And every man looked at each other and said, Then he says, you know, I know you all like to divorce each other when you're not getting along. He said, but the only reason I can see that you should be divorced is if you find out your spouse is in bed with another person and commit sexual immorality. And at the time, a man could divorce his wife just because she didn't feed him supper the right way that day. It was no question. He could do anything he wanted and walk away from it. So Jesus starts teaching this, and people in the crowd had to be looking at themselves. Then he says, don't ever break your word. Don't ever break a vow. He says, in fact, I don't even think that you should have to promise to do anything. Your word should be so solid, a simple yes or a simple no. You should have such integrity, if you told him yes and you told her no, they should know without a shadow of a doubt that your yes is a yes and your no is a no, and you shouldn't have to promise, you shouldn't have to swear, you shouldn't have to do anything but just say yes or no. And then he says, don't take revenge on the person, even if they deserve it. If somebody asked you for something, give them more than they asked for. Give them more than not only they asked for, give them more than they deserve. They ask you for a favor, go beyond what they ask you to do. And he says, why do you need to love everybody? And by everybody, I mean even the people you don't like. Love your enemies, the people who are lying about you, the people that are mocking you, the people that are persecuting you. Love them anyway. Imagine by this time the crowd is going, well, I have no hope. And then he says, you know, give to the needy. Doesn't matter. Just give to them. Pray in private. Don't try to become some kind of super spiritual Sandy or holy heaven Helen. Pray in private. Your Father knows what you want. If you're praying in public for your own benefit, you've got the glory you deserve. You're not going to get it from your Father. He says, forgive those who sin against you. Don't let your money be put before God. You can't serve two masters. Don't be a slave to the things of this world. Don't let money let you miss out. Don't let it miss out on the kingdom of God. Don't let it miss out on heaven. Don't worry to glorify you. Your money will be used to glorify God who gave it to you in the first place. And then Jesus said, in fact, not just don't worry about your money. Don't worry about anything at all. Worry will shorten your life. Worry will not add to your life. So don't worry about it. God takes care of the birds of the field, or the birds of the air, and the lilies in the field. He's going to take care of you. And this is what's so amazing. He's been speaking for two chapters, 5-6. We're now into chapter 7, verse 12. And Jesus takes every single thing that he's been talking about, this master teacher, this great teacher, sums it up with just one sentence. Matthew chapter 7, verse 12, we sometimes call it the golden rule. Do to others whatever you would like them to do to you. Everything he just said, he wraps up. And the people are going, well, that's easy enough to do. Sometimes I think you miss the point. I want you to think about this. What would your life look like if you always tried to do the same things Jesus did? What would your life look like? How would people treat you if you tried to be more righteous? Not act righteous. There's a difference. If you always tried to be more righteous, you actually tried to be more moral, to be better, to do real good than everybody around you that you came in contact with, no matter how good they already were. What if Christians had a competition to see who could be the most right? And every time we went out in the world, whoever we met, we wanted to be more moral, we wanted to act nicer, we wanted to be more righteous than everybody we came into contact with. And let's face facts, some of them are a lot easier. You know, my daughter's working at Candy Kitchen. Yesterday was a bad day. She had customers come in and try to exchange candy they'd already had for 2 days, and it was hard. They had another guy that tried to throw their credit card at her and ask her if she was paying attention to them when she'd already rung them up. That, you know, some people are a whole lot easier to be more righteous than. But then there's that person that all of us know that seems to smile all the time, that never has any word to say about anybody, that every time you come into contact, you walk away thinking, man, I feel like I'm walking on clouds. They are an encourager. What if we had a competition that we were even going to try to outdo that person? What would your life look like? What would the world look like? We live in a different world, wouldn't we? What if the people that you made mad came to you and offered to settle the argument, regardless of personal cost to them, even though you both knew you were the one that were wrong? That they didn't care about being right with man. They cared more about being right with God. What would your life look like? What would the world look like if all our Christians did that? If you're married, if you have somebody that's important in your life, that is your partner for life, how do you feel when they lust after somebody else? Even if it's somebody that is a superstar and you know they couldn't have that person, but they continually tell you how much they lust after, how does that make you feel? Well, then don't do it. If that's how it makes you feel, imagine how it makes them feel. Don't do it. Instead of divorcing your spouse, try loving your spouse, even if you don't like your spouse. Because love is a verb, it's not a noun. You made your bed, live in it.
Right
now. Told you this was controversial. But I want you to think about this. I want you to think about it. What if your spouse changed and started doing every single thing that you like, the same thing that you fell in love with them about, how would you start to feel towards them? Wouldn't your feelings change? Wouldn't you start acting a little different? You just do it first.
Yes.
Okay? You just do it first. Now, if you don't know how to do that, seek counseling. You know, seeking counseling sometimes is the most loving thing that you can do.
What if you love them but you don't like them?
Love them anyway because love is a verb. I heard a story one time. A guy walks into the counselor and he says, listen, I don't like my wife. In fact, I don't want to be with her, and she doesn't want to be with me. Counselor says, move next door. I says, move next door. He goes, yeah, because God says, love your enemies. Or love your neighbors. I says, you're not getting this. But we hate each other. Did you hate each other? We hate each other. He said, then stay married. I said, stay married. He goes, yeah, because God says, love your enemies. What if you were the one that changed, and because you changed, they changed? How does it feel? How does it feel? And some of us, we had parents that did this, so I think that's the hardest thing to get over. But I had friends of mine, people I thought I would honestly die for. But they continually broke their vows to me. They broke their promises to me. How does that make you feel? Then don't break your word to them because that's how it makes them feel. How would you feel if the people you knew that you had done wrong to? And we all don't try to pretend to be more spiritual at all. We've all hurt people in our lives, right? How would you feel if the people you did wrong to came to you and they didn't come to seek revenge, they come to say, I love you, what do I have to do to make you? And you're going, well, I was the one that messed this up. Well, then you should do that to others. If you wrong somebody, Jesus says, go make it right with them. And this is so important. This is so important. Jesus tells every single thing in the Bible, the entire Bible, 66 chapters, all hinges on this one thing. Do to others whatever you would like them to do to you, because this is the essence, this is what it means, this is all that is taught in the law and the prophets. If you do this one thing, you'll have done everything God has told you to do in His entire 66 chapters of His Word. Dare to be a disciple. and do to others whatever you would like them to do to you. And most of us hear this and we would say, I agree with that wholeheartedly. I really wish my wife would do that.
That's right. That's right.
Most of us would say we agree with this golden rule, but do we really understand what Jesus is saying here? Because here's the thing, I don't think you can truly understand the good that he's saying without understanding the bad. A good teacher will contrast two different things. He'll compare the good with the bad. A great teacher will give you something to accept and something to reject. Because at the heart of every single decision we make, we have to reject something else. And if I go here, I can't go there. If I do this in this moment, I can't do that in this moment. And by giving contrast, by giving us two things, by giving us something to reject and to accept, what we do is we make things crystal clear, don't we? And Jesus makes what he's saying, what the end result will be, he makes it crystal clear. He tells us what is at stake in the very next verses. You can enter into God's kingdom only through the narrow gate. But the gateway to life is very narrow. And the road is difficult, and only a few will find it. He contrasts narrow, broad, wide, narrow, many, few. The gate to God's kingdom is a narrow gate. The gate to hell, or some translations say destruction. The destruction is wide. Contrast, comparison. One way is wide, one way is narrow. We know the narrow gate is difficult, so by implication, the narrow gate is difficult, so by implication, since few choose it and it's difficult, that means the wide gate must be easy, and that's why so many people choose it. We have to make a choice. We have to set our minds in a certain direction. We can't be saved and unsaved at the same time. We can't walk a fence post hoping we fall in one direction in the road. There is a Y in the road. There are two gates. You can't go in both directions. You can't go in gate A and go in gate B at the same time. One way is easy, but Jesus warned us it's going to lead to destruction. It's going to lead to hell. He says, I dare you to be a disciple and take the more difficult way. Take the narrow gate, because the narrow gate may be more difficult, but the narrow gate is the only gate, not one of many gates, not one of even two gates. It is the only gate which leads to God's kingdom.
Amen.
Now, if you're not sure which road that you're on, Jesus gives us a test. Now, when I was in school, I always thought the test was the teacher. Teacher's giving me a test. Teacher's a slight test. Test is never for the teacher. The test is always for the student. The test is to see if you retain the information. The test is to see if you comprehend it, if you've learned the things they've been taught. The test is designed to see if you're moving in the right direction. And the test is found in the next verses, chapter 7, verses 15 through 20. Beware of the false prophets who come disguised as harmless sheep, but are really vicious wolves. You can identify them by their fruit. That is, you can identify them by the way they act. Can you pick grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? A good tree produces good fruit. A bad tree produces bad fruit. A good tree can't produce bad fruit, and a bad tree can't produce good fruit. So every tree that does not produce good fruit is chopped down and thrown into the fire. Yes, you can identify a tree by its fruit, so you can identify people by their actions. How can you tell what path you're on? How can you tell which gate you've gone through? Look at your life. Not in her life, not in his life. Look at your life. What are your actions? And let me assure you this. What Jesus is not saying, what I am not saying, is we are not saved from the wrath of God by our actions. It is our salvation comes through faith alone, by grace alone, by Christ alone, for the glory of God alone. But our actions, the things that we do, are the evidence of our salvation.
Yeah.
Jesus' little brother James writes it like this. He said, some people have faith, others have good deeds, others have good actions. But I say, how can you show me your faith if you don't have good deeds? I will show you my faith by my good deeds. I'll show you my faith by my good actions. You say that you have faith? Here's another scary verse. You say that you have faith? Well, even the demons in hell believe and they tremble in terror. How foolish. Can't you see faith without good deeds? Can't you see that faith without action is completely useless? In other words, we should possess what we profess. We should possess what we profess. If all we have is a profession of faith with no good deeds, no good actions, no good works, all that does is qualify us to be a tree to be chopped down and thrown into the fire. If all you have are words and no actions, qualifies you to be a demon and you should tremble in fear. We should possess what we profess. In his book, Growing Deep in the Christian Life, Swindoll tells a story. He says, this man and this woman go into this chicken restaurant, and they order two chicken dinners to go. And you can tell that they're sort of dating, and they're giggling, and they're a little happy. And they go to a picnic spot a little ways away, and they sit down, and they spread out their meal. And when the man opens up his container, the bag with his chicken in it, and this little cardboard box, when he opens up, what he finds is that a chicken is that restaurant's day deposit. There's over $800 in there, and most of it's in cash. Surprise! Well, the man gets in his car, they get in the car, they drive right back to the restaurant. The manager, who's frantic by now, he walks in and tells the manager what's happening. You can see the sense of relief on the manager. He says, man, you have to be the most honest man I've ever met in my life. He goes, I am a friend of the editor of the local newspaper. I'm going to call him. He's going to come right down. He's going to take your picture. You know, you guys are probably going to make the front page. I goes, no, you don't have to do that. And he leans over and whispers into the manager's ear, you see the woman I'm with? She's not my wife. She's somebody else's wife. See, some things aren't always as they appear. Some people aren't always as they seem. We should possess what we profess. Both in the Gospel of Mark and the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus tells of a fig tree. Fig tree is mentioned often in the Bible. He talks about this fig tree. And on this fig tree, he sees it in the distance. It's in full bloom. This fig tree looks like it has some delicious fruit in it. So Jesus walks up to the fig tree, and there's no figs. So he curses it, and it withers, and it dies. It's no good for anything but cutting down and throwing into a fire. What scares me about the church is I know people that are like that fig tree, and I'm sure you do too. They have all the leaves. They have the Christian bumper sticker. They wear the Christian t-shirt. They put occasionally a couple things on Facebook. They have the necklace. They have all the leaves. But if you search their life, there is no fruit. There is no fruit whatsoever. And that is my concern for the church of today. You say you're a Christian, but your actions say something else entirely, you are on the wrong path. You need to turn around and you need to go on the right path. If you say you believe in God, but you live in a way which denies God or in a way that goes against His Word, then you need to turn around because you've entered through the wrong gate. See, Jesus' brother James also writes, don't just listen to God's Word. You must do what it says, otherwise. He doesn't say you're fooling your neighbors. He doesn't say you're fooling the church. He said, otherwise you are fooling yourself. If you come to church every Sunday, if you give a true tithe, 10% of every dollar you make, if you come to church on Sundays and blend back in the world on Mondays. You may be hearing the word, but if you aren't producing fruit, if your actions tell a different story, if you're listening, you're not doing, you are only fooling yourself. You may fool me, you may fool the guy next to you, you may fool your husband or wife, but you're not, but you're the person you're really fooling is yourself. He said, if you have a profession of faith with no fruit, you are a bad tree. Fine words are no substitute for fine deeds. Jesus wants us to be a good tree. He wants us to be a good tree bearing good fruit. His desire is for us to dare to be disciples with good fruit, good actions. And the next verse tells us why this is so important. And this is the scariest verse in the New Testament, maybe the scariest verse in the entire Bible, at least for me. It's a terrifying verse, and the reason this verse scares me so much is we know who Jesus is talking to. He is talking to those who say they're Christians. He's talking to those who have the full expectation of getting into heaven. The next verse is so scary to me because he's talking to church members. He's talking to people who say, Jesus is my Savior. He's talking to Christians who say, I know Jesus Christ. Chapter 7, verses 21 through 23. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter into the kingdom of heaven. Only those people, listen to this, not only those are people who attend church, not only those people who give their money, not only those people who say the right thing, only those who actually do the will of my Father in heaven will enter. On judgment day, not a few, not some, but many will say to me, Lord, Lord, we prophesied in thy name. It wasn't that they weren't doing anything. Didn't we cast out demons in your name, perform many miracles in your name? But I will reply to them, I never knew you. Get away from me, you who break God's law. I pray over that. Billy Sunday, and I don't know if you know who Billy Sunday was. He was actually one of the very popular outfielders in the National League back in the 1880s. And I'm old, but I ain't that old. But he was a very popular outfielder in the National League in the 1880s. But by the first celebrated and most influential evangelist during those first two decades of the 20th century. And what he said, if you are living wrong, you cannot die right. If you are living wrong, you cannot die right. See, I can read your faces, but I cannot read your heart. Only God can see what's in your heart. You say Jesus is my Lord and Savior, but you live in such a way that on that judgment day, you'll be one of the many who hear, I never knew you, away from me, who break God's love. You say you love Jesus, but you live as if he doesn't even exist. As I read into this, I think it's important that we know Jesus Christ, but I think it's more important that Jesus Christ knows us. And how does he know you? Does he know you by your church attendance? Does he know you by how much money you give? Does he know how much of the Bible you memorize? Some of the meanest, angriest, nasty people I ever met could quote the Bible from cover to cover. Jesus says, I will know you by your fruit. I will know you by your actions, not by your words. The test as to whether your faith is sincere is by your fruit or by your lack of. Don't let your lips and your life tell two different stories, okay? Bad news is Jesus has given us these terrifying, these scary truths. But glory to God, he does not end on a negative note. Glory to God, he tells us the good news. He doesn't leave us with bad news. Jesus wraps up his sermon, the greatest sermon ever preached, with a practical application as to assure ourselves how we can make sure that we have picked the right road and gone through the right path. He says, or going through the right thing. He said, anyone who listens to my teachers, listen to this, anyone who listens to my teachings and follows it is wise. He's like a person who builds his house on solid rock. The rain and the torrents come and the floodwaters rise and the winds beat against that house, But it won't collapse because the house is built on bedrock. But anyone who hears my teachings and doesn't obey is foolish. Like a person who chooses to build his house on sand, when the rains and the floods come and the winds beat against that house, it will collapse with a mighty crash. See, it's not enough. It's not enough to quit doing what you know is wrong. See, there's another step that you have to do. This is the step that most people miss. This is the step that most people don't tell you about. There's another step. The first step is you have to make a decision against yourself.
Amen.
You have to make a decision against yourself. You know somebody, no, not me, okay. You know somebody with six-pack abs? They made a decision against themselves to go to the gym and work out every day. You know somebody with a PhD? They made a decision against themselves to stay in college, get their four-year degree, get their master's degree, and then get their PhD. They went against themselves. A lot of us, this time of year, we're watching the Olympics. If you're invited to come to the Olympics, you made a decision against yourself. You made a decision to practice for hours a day, for years and years and years, just to get a chance. You have to make a decision to go against yourself. The way you do that is, if you want to break a bad habit, you have to replace it with a good habit. If you just try to do good, if you just try to stop doing what you're doing, it will never work, because there is a void, and voids always get filled.
That's right.
In Romans chapter 8, verse 4, the Apostle Paul writes, "No longer follow your sinful nature, but follow the nature of the Spirit." It's not enough to quit following your sinful nature. You need to start following the Spirit. It's not enough to quit doing the sinful things. You have to start doing the good things. How do we do that? Jesus has already told us. Anyone who listens to my teachings and follows it as wise is like a person who builds a house on solid rock. Because your foundation is everything. Your foundation has to be built on the solid rock of God's Word and Jesus Christ. Now, before I get to the next slide, this I want you to know. The problem we have, I believe, the problem, there's so much legalism and so many Christians hurting other Christians, is because they come to church and they hear the Word of God, and instead of looking into their own hearts, they start judging the people around them. They start saying, that person can't be a Christian. Look at the fruit in their life. They don't have any, or what fruit they have is bad, and they aren't looking at themselves. The second reason is because they come to church. Maybe they watch church on TV all day long. Maybe they come to church every single day, but they never read the Scriptures themselves. I could stand up here and tell you anything, and you can build your foundation on it, and I could be speaking in absolute lies. Unless you read the Scriptures yourself, you can build your foundation on my words, which are sand, and not God's Word, which is solid rock. Reading the Scriptures, building your foundation on the solid rock of Jesus Christ, is your foundation. And the foundation is important because what you believe is how you will behave.
That's true.
If you build your foundation on God's Word, you will build it on solid rock. If you do not build your foundation on God's Word, you will build it on something else. And sometimes you don't even know. My foundation in my late teens and early 20s was built on the things of this world, and I didn't even realize it. I listened to every motivational tape. I had pictures of not my second house, but my dream house on the wall, of the car that I wanted, of the things that I wanted. I had my bucket list. I had my goals. And you know what? When I look back at that today, not one of those goals were for the glory of God. The goals were for the glory of Rob. My foundation was built on something, and I didn't even know what it was built on. It wasn't until I started reading God's Word that I saw that my foundation was built on sand and not on stone. Read your Bibles for yourself. Holiness by subtraction, holiness by just trying to take something out of your life, does not add up to righteousness. Goodness isn't the absence of badness. You can do nothing wrong and still do nothing right. If you try to take away sin in your life without filling that void that's left behind, if you don't fill it with something good, if you don't stop, if you just try to stop doing what you're doing and don't try to start doing something else, you will eventually go back to what you were doing, because voids are meant to be filled.
Amen. Amen.
Dare to be something more than a Christian. Dare to be a disciple. It is not the easy path. It's just simply the best path. It's not the wide gate. It's the narrow gate. But it's the only gate which leads you to the kingdom of God. And these are not my words. These are the words of Jesus Christ. That's why you need to read your Bible yourself. Don't build your foundation on my words. Don't build your foundation on any other preacher's words, no matter how much you like them. But read the Bible for yourself so you know what is being preached is truth. Dare to be a disciple. A building is only as good as a foundation. The foundation is everything, and the foundation is revealed in the day of the storm. How many people do you know? How many people have heard of? The storms came. They were regular church attenders. They were even having a little bit of fruit. They were walking with God. And the storm came, and they fell away. How many people do you know? The wife got cancer. The man got angry. Never went back to church. They had a bankruptcy. They never went again. The storm is the test of the foundation, and the storms will come. It's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. Somebody said there are three types of people. Those that can count and those that can't. There's three types of people. There are those that are headed into a storm. There are those who are in the midst of a storm. And there are those who are coming out of a storm. It's not a matter if you're going to have a storm in your life. Storms come. They come into everybody's life. I guarantee you the storms will come. But how you weather those storms depends on what you built your foundation on. Folks, I'm not going to have time to tell my testimony. I'm running a few minutes late already. But I'm telling you, if I had not built my foundation on the solid rock of Jesus Christ and the Word of God, I would be in the grave today. I stood upon the promises of God, and I knew they were true. My foundation was solid. And when the storms came, I might have lost a shingle. I might have lost a shutter. I might have had a problem. But I did not crumble and fall. You say you're a Christian. You say you know Jesus. But if Jesus came today, would He know you? Do you think Jesus is satisfied with the way that you're pursuing Him? Do you think Jesus would admire the fruit of your present life? Will the things that you value today, what will they be worth 100 years from now? I'm not saying it's not good to have goals. I think it's fantastic to have goals. I've had a lot of goals in my life. I have goals today. But do your goals ultimately glorify you, or do they ultimately glorify God? Do they bear fruit for you, or do they bear fruit for God? But be careful with what I'm saying, okay? Because does this mean that we have to live a flawless life? Does this mean we can never make a mistake? Does this mean that we have to be perfect? Of course not. If we could, we would not need Jesus. It's not our righteousness that we rest on. It is the righteousness of Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone that we can rest on. Philippians 3:9 proves this. Paul says, I no longer count on my own righteousness through obeying the law. Rather, I become righteous through faith in Christ. For God's way of making us right with Himself depends on faith. But it's also not a confession of what faith that redeems us. It's not a confession of faith that pays for our sins. Yes, a confession of faith is necessary, but we must possess what we profess. And Jesus warned us over and over and over again about those who confess Him with their mouth, but their actions tell a different story. Can a good tree occasionally bear fruit? And the answer is yes. I've seen a dead, rotten tree have a real pretty picture. Can a bad tree occasionally has some good fruit? Yes. Can a good tree have bad fruit? I've seen some beautiful peach trees with some rotten fruit on them. But the question is, what is the consistent and constant pattern of the fruit? What is the consistent and constant pattern of your life? What is the direction of life? Do you walk towards holiness with an occasion of sin, or do you live in sin with an occasional of holiness? See, you can do anything you want and call yourself a Christian. Wars have been started. People have been killed. Lands have been seized. Governments have been overthrown. And many other terrible things have been done by Christians in the name of Christianity, because Christian is never defined in Scripture. But the word disciple is not only defined by our Scripture. It is defined by Jesus himself. And I think that if Jesus were here today, he could say something like this. Dare to be a disciple. And be more than a Christian. Let me not only be your Savior. Allow me to be your Lord over your life and everything else. Dare to be a disciple. And turn from your selfish ways. And pick up your cross and follow me. Dare to be a disciple. And give the things of this world up, which are holding you back from knowing me. And gain the things which will last all for eternity. And allow me to know you. Dare to be a disciple and remain faithful to my teachings. Dare to be a disciple and obey my commands. Dare to be a disciple and be known for the way that you love others. Dare to be a disciple and sit at my feet and learn to be like me. Dare to be a disciple and live for me and gain the kingdom of heaven. Dare to be a disciple and produce fruit. There is no forgiveness without surrender. There's no forgiveness without repentance. There is no salvation without surrender. There is no life without death. There is no believing without following. Let me ask you this morning. Will you search your hearts and dare to be a disciple? Let me pray. Heavenly Father, I pray not only for those in this room, I pray for myself, Father. Father, I ask that you let me be more than simply a Christian, Lord. I ask you to help me by the power of the Holy Spirit, knowing that I cannot do this on my own, but I need your help to lift me up out of the miry clay and to sometimes even carry me. Help me, Lord, dare to be a disciple. Help us, Lord, as a church, to not be a church that just walks around on Sunday morning saying and doing the right things with a lot of leaves, but let us dive deep into the community and into our families and produce fruit, Lord, fruit that will last for all eternity. Lord, don't let our lips and our lives speak two different lessons. Father, help us in the name of Jesus Christ to build our hand on his solid rock and your word. Father, I ask as we leave here today that we dare to be disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we ask this in his name. The precious name of our Savior, Jesus. Amen. Folks, I'm going to just ask you, and I'm wrapping this up, dare to be a disciple. Be here Tuesday morning if you can make it. If you can't make it, just pray for us. Pray for your family. Pray for our church between 8:30 and 9:30. Dare to be a disciple. Come out Wednesday night and discuss the Holy Spirit with us, the forgotten God. Dare to be a disciple and come back next week, because I'm telling you, next week is going to be a very special lesson. It's going to be a whole lot different. It's called The Sound of God. And